In the last episode, our Vision Group journalist narrated pre-travel training to Saudi Arabia. In this episode, she continues with what happened when she tried to get an express passport to travel. She started this process of traveling to Saudi Arabia in August 2021. She was assured that the travel would be in a matter of days, but eight months later, she was with 200 other girls, patiently waiting for the opportunity. They were housed in a hostel in Tuba, Kulambiro, where as many girls were brought in as those who were leaving to go to Saudi Arabia. Some girls would leave for Saudi Arabia. Their bosses would come and read the names of the girls selected to go. For those like our undercover journalist, whose names were not yet read, had to wait for infinity, hoping and praying for an opportunity in the next batch. She was chosen for the pre-travel training instituted by the Ministry of Gender, Labour and Social Development. The training is supposed to groom the girls who are travelling for house girl work in what to expect: Arab etiquette, courtesy, how to use home appliances, and how to save or remit money to Uganda from Saudi Arabia, and so much more. They completed it at Labour College of East Africa, Namwongo Campus, on Bukasa Road. It was supposed to take 2 weeks, but their recruitment company, Zion, withdrew them after 1 week. They were then told to return home to prepare for our flights to the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. She asked Rosette, their Zion supervisor, where the ministry wouldn't know that they cheated and blocked them at the airport, and she laughed. Apparently, the owners of the training institution also work in the ministry. On March 17th, management at the college asked them to sign out that training was done. They signed out and waited for Zion management to pick them. Aisha came the following day on 18th and asked them to contribute 5,000 shillings each for transport back to Zion offices in Kulambiro. They paid and were transported in 8 taxis. When they got to the office, their bosses told them to go home for a week, because if they were found at the premises, the company would land into problems. Pre-departure orientation was supposed to be conducted for a period of not less than 14 days, according to the regulations, and a recruitment agency must deploy its domestic worker within the period of 30 days after the training. Also, the approval is submitted by the training institution to the ministry for approvals at least 7 days before the pre-departure orientation is conducted. The regulation further explains that ministry has the right to suspend accreditation of a pre-departure training of the institution if the institution does not conduct orientation for a period of 14 days. And if the institution submits false documents to the ministry or fails to submit to the ministry a schedule of the training to be conducted, its recruitment license would be revoked. The list Zion submitted to the training institution had 261 names, including those who joined them after they had started. They were told that the college would still have to wait for the 2 weeks before they submitted their certificates to the ministry for approval. On April 4th, she got a call from Zion saying she had been cleared and approved. She was therefore to report to the hostel at once. But she was also supposed to go through HIV, pregnancy, and hepatitis B tests before she would be admitted back to the hostel to wait for her visa. The Gulf Cooperation Council medical examination, which she had done in August last year, had expired, and she needed to do another. All migrant workers traveling to work in the six Gulf countries of Kuwait, Bahrain, Oman, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, and the United Arab Emirates needed a GCC medical. The girls called each other and discovered there were many who had been called. They were all excited until they arrived at the office in Kulambiro. Shamim, one of the office administrators, told her that the company wanted to deal with those who have a valid GCC medical first. Those whose medical certificates had expired had to wait. That was a freezing shot. On return to the hostel, Zion conducted a medical exam for pregnancy and HIV. A nurse took their samples and they had to wait for about 30 minutes before they got their results from Feras. On May 4th, she was called back to the hostel and told that her visa was ready. But her passport was the old machine-readable one. She didn't have the e-passport. She was asked to pay $250,000 to be helped with a new passport. There were 15 girls who needed new passports. The scaring thing was that her visa was issued on April 24th and would expire 3 months from the date of issue. On May 16th, she was assured that the passport books were out of stock, but that she could get an emergency one at a cost. The man they gave her to get for her through was Kenneth Ikinyom, who claimed to be working with the Ministry of Internal Affairs. He asked her to pay 650,000 shillings and he would get her the book in just one day. He took her through the process to show how he had no big share of the required 650,000 shillings because he had to reverse her application from Mbarara, where Zion had posted it, to Kampala. The next day, Kenneth changed the story. He said he was not able to pick the passport. He asked her to go to Chambogo and a man called Ojara would give it to her. On May 18th, while in the waiting area in Chambogo, Kenneth sent her Ojara's phone number contact at 0773-058828. She called Ojara and he told her to wait for the message. He said he had no powers to pick it for her. She was mad. She told him all the false promises she had gone through and insisted Kenneth had said Ojara would give her the passport from Chambogo. Ojara just replied that if she wanted the passport from Kampala, she had to write to the Commissioner Immigration of the Ministry of Internal Affairs first. In the next episode, our undercover journalist narrates her meeting with Internal Affairs Minister Kahinda Otafire.